Glad you're here. Our ushers are getting ready to bring attendance pads down. We ask that you just fill out the information there. Just pass it down the pew to the next person, and then when it gets to the end, pass it back and make sure you look at it. Make sure you know everybody on your row and greet them by name. We're glad all of you are here. Going to call your attention. Get out your bulletin. Want to call your attention to a couple of announcements here. First of all, I want to thank everybody who donated the poinsettias for our worship services today, and then of course again on Christmas Eve. Let's do Christmas before we get to New Year's. Christmas Eve, we look forward to that. You certainly made our sanctuary beautiful. All the worship areas throughout the Gallery Hall and upstairs in Asbury Hall as well. It looked great, and thank you for all of that. Note that on Christmas Eve, we will be having three different communion services. The first one at 4 o'clock, our family-oriented ABCs of Christmas. Tanya, David, and myself will be leading that, and we're looking forward to that. And then on that evening at 7 o'clock and again at 11, a more traditional Christmas Eve candlelight service, and I know you want to be here for that. Just so glad that looks like we're going to have a decent week. Christmas Day, I hear most of you are going to be grilling hamburgers and going to the beach. So anyway, you know, we have those Christmases like that, I guess. As my father-in-law says, we're going to pay for it. So anyway, and he's probably right. So anyway. Let's stand and let's greet one another. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Would you please stand as you're able and join me in reading the call to worship responsively? Good friends, rejoice, for God is with you.
We are breathless, still so much to be done.
Calm your spirits, take time to hear the wondrous news.
Open our ears to hear Mary's story.
Believe in the good news. We believe and rejoice. The joy of the Lord is with us. Continue standing as we sing hymn number 246, Joy to the World.
This morning, as we go to the Lord in prayer, we bring to this place our joys and celebrations. We also bring our concerns and needs, and there are many of those. And so let's bow our heads and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Mighty and loving God, as we gather in this place today, we humble ourselves before you. We humble ourselves because we truly realize that you are God. And it's a time for us to be still and know that. It's a time, O God, when we give thanks for the blessing that you have poured out upon our lives. Every one of us is blessed in ways that go beyond measure. Today, we are thankful that you love us, you recognize us, you call us by our name to follow you and to be a faithful disciple. We thank you for your grace and the forgiveness of our sins and for moving us into a right relationship with you. Oh God, today we are thankful that we have this opportunity to bring to you our joys and our celebrations, but we also bring to you our needs and our concerns, and you called us to bear our burdens on you. And so today, Lord, we remember so many in our community of faith that are hurting, that are sick, that are recovering, many that are in treatment. We pray, Holy God, for the healing that we can only find through Jesus Christ. We thank you for gifting so many in the field of healing, and what a blessing it is to be witnesses of your intervention in our lives. We think about so many that grieve in this season. Sadness can overwhelm us, but you, O God, you give us comfort, and you fill through your love the void that's in our hearts. And so today we thank you, Lord, that we have the opportunity to be the church, to come together and to encourage each other in this place, but then to go out beyond these walls into the world and to share the ministry and mission that you call us to be involved with. Every day, oh God, you speak to us. Let our ears hear. Let our eyes see. Let our voices be witness of your wonderful love. Now, Lord, we pray your blessing upon the leaders of our church and our community, upon our commonwealth and upon our nation, and certainly the world. Help us, O God, to seek your peace that you only make. We thank you, Lord, for protecting those who protect us. And now guide us as we join our hearts and our voices, and we share together the powerful prayer, the mighty prayer, the words you taught your own disciples to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask the Jason Powell family to come and light our Advent wreath.
Will you please read along with a responsive litany as printed in your bulletin? During Advent, we remember the light that shines in darkness. But the darkness has not overcome it.
Though sorrow may last through the night, joy comes in the morning.
For all who face the sting of loss, God's word speaks.
Though sorrow may last through the night, joy comes in the morning.
For all who wrestle with the unknown of tomorrow, God's word speaks.
Though sorrow may last through the night, joy comes in the morning.
For all who battle the questions that arise in the silence, God's word speaks.
Though sorrow may last through the night, joy comes in the morning.
This morning we light four candles. When the darkness of life feels overwhelming, the first candle ignites our hope in God's unfailing truth. The light of the second candle reveals the Prince of Peace when the chaos of life seems all-consuming. When humanity responds with senseless acts of hurtful words, the light of the third candle radiates God's command to love as we have been loved. The fourth candle reminds us that no matter what our circumstances, there is joy in the coming Christ who opens our eyes to the everlasting light.
Our Old Testament reading today comes from Micah chapter 5, verses 2 through 5a. But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrathah, who are one of the little clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to rule in Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return to the people of Israel. and he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall live secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be the one of peace.
Thank you so much. We've enjoyed the bells so much this season. You all have done a great job, and we do appreciate it so much. I want to invite you to stand once again and turn in your hymnals to number 219, and let's sing the first and second verse of What Child Is This? And as we sing, we'll allow our children to head on out to Little Church, and appreciate them so much.
Child is this who lay to bed on where?
Let us pray. Almighty and loving God, as the word is revealed today, we pray that the meditation of our hearts and the words of my mouth certainly would be acceptable to you. Come, O God, give us your words, the words we desperately need, that will transform our hearts to live lives as you desire. In the name of Christ we pray, amen. I've been listening to Christmas music. Have you been hearing it on the radio and so forth? I've been listening to a Lexington station that's been playing it since July 5th, I think. But anyway, I was thinking the other day, if you were to take a list, make a list of Christmas songs, and as many Christmas songs as you could possibly think of, I bet you could come up with quite a list. It might be songs like, Frosty the Snowman, or maybe All I Want for Christmas Are My Two Front Teeth, or maybe Grandma Got Run Over by a... that's on your list, okay. You might come up with Ave Maria, or Holy, Oh Holy Night, or Handel's Messiah, and everything in between. And some of those songs are silly and frivolous, I know. Some of them, though, have the power to truly transform our hearts. They give hope to the discouraged, comfort to the sorrowful, and they strengthen the weary. Today, we take a look, I think, at one of the most beautiful songs in all Scripture, a song that is surrounded by the joyous Christmas event. It's the song of Jesus' mother, Mary. And this morning, I want to take you back to Mary and Joseph. You know, the angel had just spoken to Mary, told her that she was pregnant with the Son of God, and that she will be blessed. Put yourself in Mary's shoes for a moment. She had to be overwhelmed, right? I mean, she probably needed someone to talk to, someone that she knew she could trust, someone that she knew, well, would be sensitive to her condition. I mean, think about it. How would you ever, ever explain to someone you had a visit from an angel? How would you do that? And how would you tell your parents and your boyfriend you were pregnant, even though you hadn't been with him? How are you going to explain all of this to your neighbors? Well, it turns out that Mary had a cousin named Elizabeth, who was also pregnant. You know the story. She was about 6 months along, and Elizabeth was older, way past childbearing age. But when Mary heard Elizabeth was pregnant, she knew instinctively that the two of them needed to get together. And when Elizabeth saw Mary, she said immediately, "Blessed are you among all women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb." And Mary knew immediately that this was no dream, that this, what had happened to her, was for real. And it was then that Mary said those words that I think have become one of the most beautiful songs in all of Scripture. And I want to invite you, rather than to get out your hymnal and so, or your Bible and so forth, I want you to stop. Close your eyes for a moment and hear the words of Mary.
My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in my God, Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors.
That is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Mary's song, it's a song of love. Her song is made up of images and references that come out of Genesis, that come out of Job, out of the Psalms, and out of Isaiah. And it highlights how focused Mary's thinking was on the Word of God. As it turns out, Mary actually was a student of the Scripture. She studied them like a lover would passionately memorize and consume the letters of her beloved. They not only stimulated her thinking, but they transformed her heart, her mind, and her soul. And it caused her to be amazed that God would single out a nobody like her from Nazareth to accomplish his mighty purpose. Does that make sense to you, my friends? Does it? I mean, I want to ask you, do you really understand who this God is that calls even you and me today? This is the same God, who chose Moses, a child of slaves, to deliver his people out of slavery. This is the same God who chose Samuel when he was just a little boy, and David, who was the youngest and least likely in his family, chose them both to be leaders of the people. I wonder today, on this fourth Sunday of Advent, is God calling you? Is God calling you not because you're strong, not because you're wise, not because you're beautiful, but because God has called you? And the honor and glory belong always and only to God. See, Mary's song is a song of love, but it's also a song of faith. And I'd ask you, how is your faith today? You know, in Hebrews 11, verse 1, it says, faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. But it believes, and this is the key, friends, it believes that because God has declared something, it's already happened. Even if you can't see it, feel it, taste it, touch it, or hear it. And so in this song, Mary proclaims that God has gone out and he has scattered the proud and the arrogant. He's pulled the mighty from their thrones. He's exalted the poor and satisfied the hungry with good things and sent the wealthy away empty-handed. And as she speaks those words, my friends, her visible circumstances are no different. Her life hasn't changed. Think about it. She's still a young peasant girl out of Nazareth. The Roman rulers still rule in her neighborhood with an iron fist. And the rich keep getting richer, and the poor, you know, they're still struggling along. But Mary could sing, and she gives praise because she has already seen the vision of the changed society that God is bringing into this world, where wrongs eventually will be righted, where the injustices will be corrected, where the oppressed and the downtrodden will be lifted up, and those who have exalted themselves will be humbled before the Lord. Mary's song, it's a song of faith, but it's also a song of hope. It's a song of hope that has strengthened and been encouraged by her faith. It's a hope that's based on the promise that God made to Abraham and all his descendants thousands of years before. And as believers, my friends, we should always be firmly anchored in the promises of God. I've told you there are over 7,000 promises in the Holy Scriptures, and that's where our faith needs to be anchored. We need that so much. You've heard people talk about the unpredictable circumstances. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. Well, friends, I'm going to tell you, circumstances will come. Some will be good, some will be bad, but they'll come and they'll go. But God's promises will always be fulfilled, and they'll never go away. Jesus said it himself. He said, my words will never pass away. And so Mary's hope is firmly anchored in what God has promised. Is that where your hope is today? You see, we talked about Mary's song. It's been a song of love, a song of faith, and a song of hope. Because of the unique way God had singled Mary out to carry the eternal word, Jesus, in her womb. Isn't that amazing? You know, that ought to make us go, yeah, it is. That's pretty neat. But you want to hear something really weird? God has also handpicked and personally selected you and you and you and me to do the very same thing. No, we're not going to have to give birth to Jesus. I understand. But the eternal Word of God, friends, it still today has flesh on it. And it's expressed and looks like you and me and your neighbor. You want to see the eternal word of God? Turn. Turn around. Look. Go ahead. Turn. Look at your neighbors. There it is. Do you see it? It's in our hearts. Hopefully it's on our faces. It's in our lives. And we live it everywhere we go. Our bodies, my friends, were created to be a dwelling place for God. Each one of us is a sacred vessel through which God Himself can be known in our homes, in our schools, in our places where we work and where we play. And so in this Advent season, my friends, God comes to us, the least likely and the least likely of places. And God says to you and me, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you. Now, my family, the truth is, God doesn't force Himself on anybody. But He takes the initiative and He makes the invitation. Mary responded to that invitation. She said, well, I'm a servant of the Lord. May it be to me as you have said. My beloved family, it is my honor today to get to stand in front of you and proclaim we have a living hope. We have a steadfast faith and the experience of God's life-transforming love. Because long ago, a simple woman named Mary said, here I am, Lord. Now, the world we live in, hurting and broken, it awaits our response to that very same invitation. I'm wondering, will we let Mary's song become our song too? Let us pray. Mighty God, You call us out of the mystery of faith to be Your people, real and alive, to be in this place and to share a great transforming power, a power that only can come from God. And so, Lord, as we celebrate this birth, the birth of our Savior and Your Son and our Lord, we give thanks. Thanks that the invitation to serve does not stop with Him but continues in us. A world awaits us, O God, hungry for this good news. We pray that our lives will be the eternal word of God. And let others see that now in us, on us, and through us. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. My family, as we respond to the word, I want to invite you, as our ushers come forward, I want to invite you to prepare yourselves to offer your gifts and your tithes to Almighty God.
Grateful that you allow, that you place a call upon our lives. And that, like Mary, we can respond joyfully and give you our gifts. And we ask that you bless these gifts in the name of that baby Jesus. We pray, amen.
Remain standing as we sing our closing hymn, number 249. There's a song in the air. Verses 1 and 2. Mighty God, as we go from this place, we give you thanks for this time, a time to gather, a time to pray, a time to encourage, and a time to seek your truth and peace. Lord, bless us now with that peace, peace that passes all understanding. And it's in the name of Christ we pray. Amen. God bless all of you. And before you go, let's sing together, God be with you till we meet again.